Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents By Any Other Name, A Cultural History of the Rose, by Simon Morley, narrated by Jennifer M. Dixon. Preface. Man hands on misery to man, writes the English poet Philip Larkin with stoic resignation. But man also hands on pleasure, love, beauty, compassion, enchantment, and hope, and to these propitious ends flowers have proved to be steadfast allies for thousands of years. But of all the flowers, it is the rose that has been most often co-opted to whisper of peace and truth and friendliness unquelled. The rose has helped create atmospheres conducive to the heart and gives beautiful material form to the tenderer dimensions of our lives. As a gift, a symbol, a focus of aesthetic attention, a medicine, a distilled oil, a perfume, a culinary ingredient, and as a plant lovingly cared for and cultivated, the rose has participated in social transactions that help establish, nurture, and sometimes commemorate relationships between the living, the dead, the divine, and the everyday. Today, the rose is the world's favourite flower. It is no exaggeration to say that, at least in the Western world, roses may be one of the very first things a newborn baby sees, so common a gift is it for new mothers. From there, roses will enter our lives in many guises: homegrown, foreign, painted, sartorial, aromatic, imaginary. In fact, roses are likely to be present at many of the most important moments in your life: births, birthdays, courtships, intimate dinners, weddings, anniversaries, funerals. The US adopted the rose as its official national flower as recently as 1986, during the Reagan administration, when a powerful pro-rose lobby won out against the botanical competition, which included the marigold, dogwood, carnation, and sunflower. This statement, in support, says much about the ubiquity of the rose today. They grow in every state, including Alaska and Hawaii. Fossils show they have been native of America for millions of years. The only flower recognized by virtually every American is the rose. The name is easy to say and recognizable in all Western languages. It is one of the few flowers in bloom from spring until frost. It has exquisite colors, aesthetic form, and a delightful fragrance. Growth is versatile, from miniatures a few inches high to extensive climbers. Roses mature quickly and live long. They add value to property at minimal expense. The range of varieties is such that there are roses to suit everyone. As no other flower, the rose carries its own message, symbolizing love, respect, and courage. The iconic American hippie rock band Grateful Dead had a penchant for roses and would no doubt have agreed with this accolade. The cover of their second album, released in 1971, shows a drawing of a skull garlanded with red roses, lifted and adapted from an illustration in an early translation of the Sufi classic, the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam. We will be encountering the Sufis and their roses on several occasions in this book. "I've got this one spirit that's laying roses on me," said band member and lyricist Robert Hunter. "Roses, roses, can't get enough of those bloody roses. There is no better allegory for life, dare I say it, than roses." Grateful Dead and the United States government didn't agree on very much, but they seem to have agreed on this. My personal fascination with the Queen of Flowers began one gloomy afternoon in London in November 2003, while I was walking home from the tube and feeling sorry for myself. Suddenly, and for what seemed like the very first time, I noticed how many of the small front gardens of the terraced houses I passed every day had roses growing in them. I was especially struck by the fact that many of these rose bushes were still in bloom, even in late autumn. The discovery of colourful November roses cheered and inspired, and from that moment I started paying closer attention to roses. Soon after, I planted my first rose bushes in my East London garden. Peace and Zephyrine Drouin. I also began to study the history of the rose in earnest. When we moved to central France in 2005, I set about planting a very modest history of the rose garden there, focusing on 19th and mid-20th century hybrids, but also including, at one extreme, wild species roses, and at the other, contemporary English roses. Since 2010, I have lived much of the year in the Republic of Korea, where I teach at a university. Here, too, I grow roses, but I also regularly return to our house in France and, with help, manage to take care of and develop the garden. I'm certainly lucky that, on the whole, roses seem to thrive on neglect. By Any Other Name is not written by a botanist, horticulturalist, or an especially devout gardener. My professional background is fine art and art history, but an avid interest in the status of the rose as both a beautiful plant and a cultural icon has compelled me to write about it. This book, therefore, is the result of intellectual curiosity about the rose's hold on our psyche, combined with my emotional responses to the arresting presence of roses in our gardens and parks, and my experience of growing them. It is also founded on the belief that exploring this subject will illuminate much more than simply the Queen of Flowers. Introduction. Juliet. What's in a name? That which we call a rose, by any other name, would smell as sweet. William Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet. In May 1912, the 25-year-old English poet Rupert Brooke was sitting in the Café des Westins in Berlin, missing home and composing a poem that would become one of his best-loved, The Old Vicarage, Grantchester. In the poem, Brooke uses the tulip and the rose as metaphors for national character. The conformist Germans, he declares, live in a society where tulips bloom as they are told, while in his own homeland, unkept about those hedges blows an English unofficial rose. Earlier that same year, in Lawrence, Massachusetts, a strike of female textile workers became known as the Bread and Roses Strike. Not long before, the American women's suffrage activist Helen Todd had made an inspiring speech in which she declared, "Woman is the mothering element in the world, and her vote will go toward helping forward the time when life's bread, which is home, shelter, and security, and the roses of life, music, education, nature, and books, shall be the heritage of every child that is born in the country, in the government of which she has a voice." The phrase "bread and roses" quickly became a rallying cry for those advocating for women's and workers' rights, and went on to inspire both a poem and a popular song. Soon after the First World War, in which Rupert Brooke died, Ernst Junger, a citizen of the land he derided and against whom the war had primarily been fought, also appropriated the rose, but to very different ends. In Storm of Steel, Junger's memoir of fighting on the Western Front, published in 1920, he reflects on the restless spirit that made young men like him and Brooke so eager to go off to war and to exult in death. "Grown up in an age of security," wrote Junger, "we shared a yearning for danger, for the experience of the extraordinary. We were enraptured by war. We had set out in a rain of flowers, in a drunken atmosphere of blood and roses." Also, in 1920, the French rose breeder Joseph Pernet Doucet, the Wizard of Lyon, marketed a rose called Souvenir de Claudius Pernet. It was a floral memorial to Pernet Doucet's eldest son, who died fighting the Germans, and in the early 1920s must have stood for much more than just the memory of one Rosarian's dead son. But in the event, this particular rose would have an impact well beyond the usual new rose, because Souvenir de Claudius Pernet became one of the parents of the most important rose of the second half of the 20th century, the yellow hybrid tea, called in France Madame Amélien, in the homeland of Ernst Jünger, Gloria Dei, and in Britain and the United States, peace. These early 20th century people clearly belonged to a culture in which the rose had a powerful, resonant presence. For Rupert Brooke, the juxtaposition of a wild rose with the domesticated tulip became a way to evoke the differences between a nation that permits romantic rebellion and encourages individualistic liberty, and one that he believed imposed social conformity. For Helen Todd, struggling for the rights of working-class women in the United States, the domesticated garden and cut roses were adopted as well-established symbols of the kinder, more pleasurable and sophisticated rewards of life which were being denied the workers. For Ernst Jünger, these same cultivated roses, filtered through a rich corpus of poetry and art, were emblematic of the heady union between romance and violence that fed the myth of heroic martyrdom, an indication that the rose sometimes blossoms close to the dark and dangerous origins of our social values. For Pernet Duchet, in stark contrast, roses were a livelihood, plants that were the result of thousands of years of coevolutionary development with humanity, and which in Pernet Duchet's time had become the flowers of choice in gardens large and small across the Western world, an indispensable sartorial accessory for ladies and gentlemen, as well as a mainstay of poetry, art, and design. A poet sees a metaphor, a social reformer, a symbol of the good life, a rose breeder, a cash crop, a lover, his beloved, a scientist, an endangered ecological habitat, a writer, a limitless subject for his book. What we see depends on our individual, professional, and communal perspectives, and also on unconscious influences exerted by our upbringing. Once the rose becomes cultural, it ceases to be just a beautiful plant. It can never be divorced from some kind of ideology. In cultural terms, we will always be considering a pagan rose, a Christian rose, an Islamic rose, a mystical rose, an alchemical rose, a national rose, a capitalist rose, a patriarchal rose, and, most recently, a westernizing rose. The rose family is native to the entire temperate regions of the Northern Hemisphere, and when our ancestors first migrated tens of thousands of years ago from Africa to environments located between the Tropic of Cancer and the 60th parallel north, they also began living alongside roses. Eventually, the active domestication of roses, along with other plants, was first undertaken in two regions, China and the Fertile Triangle, which today includes Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, Palestine, Jordan, the northeast and Nile Valley regions of Egypt, the southeastern region of Turkey, and the western part of Iran. Here, within relatively complex societies, which prospered through the use of irrigation agriculture and that were characterized by social stratification and advanced record-keeping skills, there evolved a culture of flowers. Most especially in the Fertile Triangle, the rose became intimately involved with key social values. The earliest references to domesticated roses are from 2200 BC in Sumeria, a Mesopotamian civilization situated between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. Gradually, cross-cultural interactions led to the spread of both the rose plant and the evolving symbolism associated with it across far-flung geographical regions. Love of the rose spread westwards, first to ancient Greece, then to Rome. A tablet excavated in Pylos on the Peloponnesian Peninsula, likely from the 13th century BC, mentions aromatized oils that include rose extract. The Greeks encountered roses in a wide variety of contexts and incorporated them into their social practices and, over time, in a feedback loop, individual and communal ties were established and reinforced. The Romans largely seem to have imitated the Greeks, but they added some features of their own to the romance with the rose, and as their empire expanded, the rose went with them. Much later, after an initial campaign against the paganism of the culture of flowers, the Roman Catholic Church embraced the rose, and eventually it took on other significances within secular modern society. We can trace the spread of the rose as a plant of special interest to humanity by studying the origins of the words that different cultures have evolved to describe it. Nowadays, the English and French languages share the same word, rose. Italian and Spanish have rosa. In German, it is rosen. In Russian, posa, rosa. All these words are rooted in the Latin rosa, which in its turn derives from the Greek rhodon, so an expert in roses is called a rhodologist. In Arabic, it is wada, in modern Persian, gol, and in Turkish, gül, which all also mean more generally flower, a sign of the rose's preeminence within the cultures of the Near East. The spread of Islamic culture ensured the growth of more etymological branches. In India, for example, the Hindi word for rose is gulab, a borrowing from the Persian and an indication that the adoption of the rose within Indian culture was largely due to the Mughals, Muslim invaders from Central Asia, who brought the love of the rose within Islam with them when they invaded the region. The direct linguistic origins of all these non-European words is also, probably, the Greek word rhodon, which may have evolved from the old Persian word wordi, which is linked etymologically to the Parthian wa. The Parthian Empire covered the region of what is now Iran and Iraq from the end of the BCs to the beginning of the Christian era. Then again, some etymologies find the roots of the Greek word in vardos, one of the Aryan dialects of the Middle East, in which case it derives from the name of thorn bushes in general. In many of the etymologies stemming from the Greek, although not in Arabic, Persian, Turkish, and Hindi, the same word is used to signify both a plant and a colour. English is the major exception of all the European languages, as we normally say pink for the colour, not rose, although this is in fact a surprisingly recent secession, dating from the 18th century. The standard homonym linking a specific area of the colour spectrum and a specific family of plants reminds us that traditionally the rose was considered in Europe to be primarily a pale red flower, and that long ago a link was established between one area of the colour spectrum and one particular flower. Along with this colour came specific feelings and associations. So when Homer in the Iliad talks of the rosy-fingered dawn, and Edith Piaf in the middle of the 20th century sings of La vie en rose, in both cases a plant and a colour are being simultaneously evoked. Homer makes an analogy with a natural phenomenon, and Piaf with the unrealistic state of mind associated with being in love. This colour-plant link is still maintained in English to some extent. For example, when we say a sunset has rosy hues, or use the phrase rose-tinted glasses. If you want to make a clear distinction between a colour and a plant in French, for example, you say un rosier for the plant, but for the flower it is still une rose, just as the colour is rose. This complex etymological tree reveals that cultural awareness of a group of plants, characterised by mostly light red coloured flowers, prickles and hips, fruit, first emerged in the Fertile Triangle and spread westwards. But there are other independent etymologies and histories to consider. In China, which was another important centre for the domestication of flowers, wild roses were traditionally called either qiangwei or migi, and perpetual or repeat flowering roses were huijiwa. Nowadays, all flowers from the genus Rosa are named migui. In Japanese, a rose flower or flowers is bara no hana, or today also often rozu, a loan word from English. In Korean, the rose is called jangmi, a borrowing from the Chinese. The rose is also native to other regions, North America, for example. The Anishinaabe, or Algonquin tribal peoples, whose culture once stretched from Minnesota to Maine and Indiana to Hudson Bay, Ontario, referred to the Ojiniminagawonj, meaning mother fruit from small bush, a term that encompasses several different indigenous rose species, and draws special attention not to the plant's flowers, but to the shared property of usefully edible hips. Today, scientific descriptions of the various members of the rose family use the system of binomial nomenclature, invented in the 18th century by the Swedish botanist Carl Linnaeus, in which plants are described by usually two Latin words, one denoting the genus, the other the species. So, the species rose known in English as the dog rose, or dog rose, is designated botanically as Rosa canina, or simply R. canina. Canina is Latin for dog. A further classificatory level is sometimes involved when several roses of the same group have different characteristics, but are still botanically of the same line. In the damask rose group, for example, there are varieties called Rosa damascena sempiflorens and Rosa damascena bifera. Before Linnaeus, however, several of the plants referred to now collectively as roses might not have carried the same generic name. For the ancient Greeks, what botany calls Rosa canina and the English-speaking world the dog rose was known as Chinos batos. It was only the domesticated roses, such as the gallicas, that were referred to as roda, roses. In Shakespeare's time, the dog rose and other wild roses were commonly called briars, or canker blooms, and the word rose tended to refer only to domesticated garden varieties. In other words, prior to Linnaeus, a major form of classification was to distinguish between those thorny flowers, which humans, for one reason or another, had chosen to domesticate, and those they had not. The former were called roses and cherished, the latter were something else. In fact, historically speaking, the difference between the domesticated and the wild was of paramount importance in determining the value given to the non-human world in general. When we dedicate our time and effort to a specific rose, or indeed anything non-human, we are, in a sense, imprinting human culture on it. In Sonnet 54, Shakespeare makes a distinction between the garden roses, like the damask, and the canker blooms, like the wild hedgerow dog roses, which live unwooed and unrespected, fade, die to themselves. Because we attend to and care for the sweet roses that grow in our gardens, they outlive their show within our imagination and memory, within culture. Of their sweet deaths are sweetest odours made. Antoine de Saint-Exupéry makes a similar point in his famous fable, The Little Prince, but shifts the emphasis from collective to personal value. As the little prince learns from the fox, compared to his own special rose, all the other roses are beautiful, but you are empty, and what makes his rose unique is that she is the one I have watered, and it is for her that I have killed the caterpillars, and it is she I have listened to, complaining or boasting or sometimes remaining silent. Because of the special attention lavished upon them, domesticated roses often end up with several aliases, depending on where they grow and who is naming them. For example, in Shakespeare's time, an important rose, known today as Rosa Gallica officinalis, had several aliases in the English language. Apothecary's rose, officinalis, means apothecary, Gallica rose, Gallic rose, French rose, or Provence rose. These other names referring to the rose's close association with France, and in particular with the town of Provence, where they were cultivated as a cash crop. In Persia, the Damask rose was and still is often called the Gole Mohammadi, Mohammadi rose, Muhammad's rose, and in Levantine Arabic it is Al-Warda, while in Europe it is often known as the Rose of Castile. Newer roses can have more than one name. The rose called Peace in the UK and US is known in France as Madame Armeillon. The philosopher and novelist Umberto Eco called his celebrated novel The Name of the Rose, knowing full well that the title could have any number of interpretations. In the novel's postscript, Eco noted that the word rose conjures up such a multitude of different meanings that it fruitfully disoriented the reader, who was unable to choose just one interpretation. In the academic world, Eco is primarily known as a champion of unlimited semiosis, that is, for celebrating the fluid meanings of the signs and symbols we use. He chose the rose precisely because it could mean so many different things and thereby opened up greater freedom of interpretation. The last line of Eco's novel is the Latin couplet, Stat rosa pristina nomine, nomina nuda tenemus. Yesterday's rose endures in its name. We hold empty names. A phrase that the medieval protagonists in the story would have understood as making reference to the impermanence of life. But for Eco, the emptiness is meant to be semiotic, a reflection of the fact that the rose can mean more or less anything or nothing. For as we will see, the condition of unlimited semiosis, of the rose meaning so many different things, clearly also has less positive and liberating connotations. Ultimately, all the various cultural associations the rose has accumulated over the centuries are grounded in human encounters with its natural beauty. A fragment once attributed to the Greek poet Sappho, who died around 580 BC, translated here by the Victorian poet Elizabeth Barrett Browning, confirms the rose's preeminence in relation to beauty for the ancient Greeks, but even more so for the Victorian English. If Zeus chose us a king of the flowers in his mirth, he would call to the rose and would royally crown it. For the rose, oh, the rose, is the grace of the earth, is the light of the plants that are growing upon it. For the rose, oh, the rose, is the eye of the flowers, is the blush of the meadows that feel themselves fair, is the lightning of beauty that strikes through the bowers on pale lovers that sit in the glow unaware. But while recognizing and celebrating the central importance of humanity's relationship with the rose, it is important not to lose sight of the fact that in this story we will often be confronting what seem to us, the people of the present, the unacceptable prejudices of the past. So, for example, while historically men are compared to strong and clever animals like lions or foxes, women are likened to pretty plants like the rose. Behind such analogies lie specific cultural ideas about roles and status. Also, as we will see, the symbolic meanings attached to the rose often reflect the sexual obsessions and insecurities of men down the ages. Furthermore, we need to take into account the fact that even something as seemingly innocuous as a rose can be deployed as a tool of aggressive cultural expansionism. The rose may be today the world's favourite flower, but this has much to do with the fact that historically it is a flower of significant symbolic and horticultural importance, primarily in the West, and that alongside Western power, this cultural value has been exported and imitated globally over the past 100 years. When seen as a cultural sign, the rose can be described as a very potent pattern of information that has been replicated prolifically in human memory and more in some cultures than others. The rose in this sense is what the evolutionary biologist Richard Dawkins terms a meme. These days, we are familiar with this word, thanks to its use to describe the contagious sharing of attention-grabbing data over the internet. But in a deeper sense, a meme is how a culture's ideas and beliefs get perpetuated in ways that are similar to how the gene is involved in biological natural selection. As patterns of information, a meme replicates across the memories of individuals, largely because people imitate each other. It travels down through the generations and within societies in the present day, thereby helping to bring social unity. Some memes prove more successful than others, and as a result, they will spread and grow through a process of contagion or imitation, replicating prolifically. The less successful die out. All a meme needs to survive and spread is sufficiently robust cultural attributes that give it an advantage over other memes. In this sense, a meme takes on a life of its own. Dawkins also coined the term memeplex to describe cultural formations in which a number of compatible memes consolidate in mutual support to become a more powerfully effective cultural force, one which can, as a result, outperform other less powerful memes. We can call the rose a powerful amalgam of memes, a very successful memeplex that has evolved or copied itself by adapting to new cultural conditions, building in protections for different aspects of the memeplex, while always remaining connected in the human mind as a significant pattern of information. This rose memeplex has proven especially useful in giving tangible form to the subjective qualities of sensation and emotion, to abstract concepts related to our tenderest feelings, aspects of human life that cannot be grasped or easily seen. We use something tangible and familiar that is accessible to the senses to give them comprehensible and communicable structure. But just like a gene, the rose meme is selfish in the sense that its goal is replication or self-propagation. Some aspects of the rose memeplex are inspiring, some are useful, some are neutral, and some are even actively harmful. When the rose helps us express our genuine feelings of love for someone, this is certainly an inspiring and useful meme. When roses decorate a room, they are probably best described as neutral. But sometimes roses can be involved in fraudulence and falsity. In and of itself, the rose memeplex's only goal is to pass itself on, to replicate. Any self-proclaimed cultural history of this special plant must be ready to engage with the notion of culture in the two senses defined by the Merriam-Webster Dictionary. The customary beliefs, social forms, and material traits of a racial, religious, or social group, and also the act or process of cultivating living material. When approached as a plant, the rose is primarily something of interest to the botanist and gardener, and related to the various meanings given to the care and cultivation of the natural world, and to the practical and economic considerations that arise from this attention. Engaging with the rose as a plant means recognizing its dependency on the soil, the elements, and often the imperfect regard of concerned humans. We will then be interested in the ecologically and biologically particular, which is determined by time and characterized by uncertainty, and this has the effect of rooting us in the earth and keeping us in contact with the tangible. Crucial to the story of this organic rose is the fact that before the second half of the 19th century, as the British horticulturalist Jack Harkness writes, nearly all European roses flowered for a few weeks, like the cherry, the lilac, the hawthorn, the apple and the broom. But then, in the late 19th century, the miracle of flowering again and again made the rose a very special plant. For in what often seems like an obsessive quest for a master race of marketable roses, breeders created rose plants that would be significantly different from what they saw as an improvement upon the roses of the past. In practice, this meant that, equipped with the scientific knowledge that allowed for a more reliable outcome and encouraged by very favourable market forces, modern rose breeders aimed to take the best characteristics of the roses traditionally native to Europe and the Near East and blend them with the roses of China. The result of such dedicated attention is the dominant roses of today. Recent humanly engineered mutations, the products of artificial selection. They are very different from the roses Shakespeare must have had in mind when he imagined Juliet likening Romeo to one. The word Shakespeare used is the same we use, and symbolically speaking, the associations it conjures up remain closely allied with those of Shakespeare's time. But the plant is very different. In fact, the roses of today are even significantly different from the ones our four representative voices from the beginning of the 20th century would have known. So the impact on the physical nature of the rose of this sustained human interest cannot be underestimated. Roses are thoroughly people plants in the sense that many of them are wholly intertwined with human interests and values. In thinking today about how the rose might continue to replicate and reinvent itself, we must also consider how humanity's relationship with it is being changed in the light of the current ecological crisis. Once upon a time, human historical narratives, traditionally narrowed to the stories told by and about powerful male humans, were characterized by overt or implicit praise of humanity's uniqueness, superiority, and essentially benign role. We could claim to be custodians of God's creation or of Earth's bounty. But today, in the Anthropocene, we have become painfully aware of the devastating effects humanity is having on the Earth's ecosystem, and especially of how the failure to address the crisis will impact on future generations. The logic of the techno-scientific system, the domination of fauna and flora, but also other peoples and cultures, has increasingly set humanity at odds with nature. But this tacit assumption of our superiority to the rest of the natural world is being profoundly challenged, and while the exceptional character of the human animal, when compared to all the others, even our closest mammalian relatives, is beyond question, we are now coming to terms with the realization that in the not-too-distant future we might become extinct along with millions of other organisms, and that this collective demise to a significant extent will be due to our monumental stupidity. Seen from a non-anthropocentric perspective, and from the midst of today's ecological crisis, human reason, perverted into a rigid and nature-abhorring rationalism, looks worryingly malign. You might think that this tragic situation and the soul-searching it makes necessary need not trouble us while considering something as innocuous as the cultural history of the rose, but it seems obvious to me that if we are to do the rose full justice, it needs to be seen within this wider contemporary context of ecological crisis, just as we must consider the history of the rose in relation to the perceived prejudices of the past, and not simply as a delightfully coloured and sweetly scented escape from these realities.
1. Rosa, Meeting the Family.
The longest living rose is thought to be 1,000 years old. It is the species Rosa canina, and it climbs up the wall of the apse of the Cathedral of Hildesheim in northern Germany, where, like all Rosa canina, for a couple of weeks in the spring, it produces a profusion of pale pink five-petaled flowers. The rose at Hildesheim was recorded in 815, when the cathedral was founded, which means it must already have been growing there before the structure from that period was erected, and it was deliberately preserved by the builders. A fire destroyed most of this building in 1046, and the rose survived that setback. The most dangerous period of its life was quite recent, however, and again had nothing to do with old age or any of the natural enemies of the rose. In March 1945, the cathedral was completely destroyed by Allied bombing and fire, but after the war, when rebuilding began, it was discovered that the rose was still growing amid the rubble from the succouring roots which survived the conflagration. Therefore, despite the rose's substantial size today, it is actually only the growth of 70 or so years we can see. Why is a rose called a dog? One theory is because of an ancient belief that the root of one form cures the bite of a rabid dog. Another theory draws attention to the shape of the prickles, which bring to mind canine fangs. But to the people who built Hildesheim Cathedral, the plant growing up the wall was probably called something completely different. Today, in German, a dog rose is often called simply a Heckenrose, hedge rose. This impressive, dare I say dogged, rose is clearly an exemplary model of adaption and longevity under extreme circumstances. From birth, it has been surrounded by all the insects and herbivorous animals that want to eat it, and numerous other kinds of predators and other competitive plants, as well as various potential air and soil-borne bacterial and fungal diseases. Meanwhile, of course, it has needed to somehow propagate and disperse its offspring. But despite what must seem to us to be some serious evolutionary disadvantages, like all plants, the ancestors of this dog rose evolved in order to prosper maximally, using very different ways of getting what it needed when compared to humans and other animals. In fact, somewhere around 400 million and 1 billion years ago, the plant world of which the rose family became a part started evolving very differently to the fauna. Animals move, while plants are stationary. Animals consume, while plants produce. Animals make carbon dioxide, while plants use it. Plants developed the ability to grow towards essential resources, which are light, water, and mineral nutrients, and to move towards the sites of photosynthesis and growth. They are therefore capable of harvesting sunlight's energy, converting it to chemical energy, and storing it in organic structures. As a distinct species within the plant world, the dog rose and its relatives also came up with several of their own unique solutions, ones that set them apart from most other plants. Roses evolved to self-pollinate. They contain both male and female sex organs, using the wind, insects and birds to propagate by dispersing seeds. To further this goal, they display colourful flower petals and often secrete an alluring scent to attract the attention of insects, such as honeybees. Some roses, like the dog, can withstand the pull of gravity by structurally reinforcing themselves through growing their long, arching canes into other shrubs and trees, and, as in Hildesheim, they can enlist the assistance of a stone wall or other useful human-made vertical structures. At some point in the rose's evolution, a chance mutation led to leaves becoming prickles or thorns, which proved an excellent additional means of self-defense and also added to the rose family's ability to reach into trees or other structures to anchor itself and thereby increase height and stability of growth. A dog rose is moderately thorny, with fang-like prickles at intervals all along its cane. Some roses, such as the damask family and the rugosas, are very thorny, while at the other extreme there are a few roses that are almost, or even completely, thornless, such as the Bourbon rose, Zephyrine Drouin. Botanically speaking, since Linnaeus, roses have belonged within the broad classification of plants called rosaceae, which contains a staggering 3,100 species and 107 genera worldwide, which includes apples, plums, pears, and strawberries, among others. The reason the apple and the rose belong together is because Linnaeus named and grouped plants according to their sexual organs. All the plants in the rosaceae family have similarities in their stamens and pistils, their male and female aspects. Thanks to Linnaeus, botanical taxonomy became extremely well organized, but also frighteningly complex. The genus Rosa is divided into four subgenera, plus Rosa proper, which is then further subdivided into 10 subsections. According to Peter Beale's classifications, these include, for example, Canine, native to the Middle East and Europe and nudging further east towards Afghanistan, and of which the dog rose is a member. Gallicane, native of the Middle East and Europe, Cassiorhodon, native to pretty much the whole of the world between the Tropic of Cancer and below the Arctic Circle, except North Africa and the southern and western states of the USA, Cinstile, similarly prolific, but avoiding the cold north, North Africa and most of Russia and the USA, and Chinensis, native to only China, Kashmir and Nepal. Each genus is distinct, having its own special but linked characteristics, such as the shape of prickle, flower, leaf and hips. But for us amateurs, roses can be more conveniently divided into just three basic categories. 1. Species roses. 2. Classic roses, sometimes referred to as old garden roses, those in existence before 1867. And 3. Modern roses. The longest living roses are the species roses, like the one in Hildesheim. Old garden and modern roses can live for up to 200 years. The shortest lived is the tea rose, native of southern China, which only survives for between 30 and 50 years. In general, the old shrub roses that flower just once can survive much longer than their modern relations, which are bred primarily for continuous or repeat flowering. Here, working from the top of the rose plant to the bottom, are the key technical descriptive terms. The corolla, or flower, consisting of petal, petaloid, anther, pistil, stigma, sepal, calyx, peduncle, prickle, bract, side bud, bud union, hip, leaf, leaflet, stipule, cane, stem, crown, sucker, and feeder roots. Rose flowers can be just an inch in diameter or as much as 6. Their appearance on the shoot, their inflorescence is the technical term, can be in dense clusters or individually. A species rose's flowers are usually clustered in groups of 1 to 3, but some East Asian species, like Rosa multiflora, bloom in large panicles. Garden roses, like the modern floribundas, bloom in panicles of 50 to 100 flowers on a single shoot. Flowers come on the ends of long, arching stems, straight or short, stocky ones. Flower structure is described as single, where there are blooms with 5 to 7 petals each, like the dog rose, which has 5, semi-double, meaning the flower has more petals, between 8 to 15, double, 16 to 25, full, 26 to 40, and very full, up to 100, hence the name of one species rose, Rosa centifolia. The shape of individual flowers also vary enormously. They are usually classified as flat, with petals opening wide to expose the stamens, like the dog rose and most species roses, cupped, where there are more petals, and the outer ones are slightly longer than those towards the centre and curving inwards, forming a cup shape, so the stamens are hidden. Globular, with even more enclosed blooms that completely hide the stamen amid a plentitude of petals, and quartered, where the blooms consist of many petals tightly packed into a cup shape, standing straight up and flattened against each other. The ensemble of petals tend to divide into four equal parts: high-centred, in which the petals at the centre stand above the outer opened petals; rosette, which comprises double flowers with slightly overlapping petals of different sizes, which maintain an open form; and pompons, which are small, rounded blooms made up of numerous tiny petals. The typical cut rose given on Valentine's Day is high-centred. As mentioned, traditionally the period of inflorescence of European species roses is limited, almost exclusively, to a short period in late spring or early summer, with the exception of the autumn damask or four-season rose, whose name indicates its special feature, and the musk rose, Rosa moscata, which blossoms in late summer or early autumn. The inflorescence of East Asian roses, by contrast, can last for extended periods, even into winter, which is called remontancy, or repeat blooming. One interesting question, which I return to, is how and when this remontancy gene reached Western Europe. The flowers of the longest resident species roses of Europe are coloured pink or light red, but can also be white. By contrast, in addition to pink, light red, and white, there is a Near Eastern species rose that is yellow, and also long-established orange and deep red hybrid varieties. Technically speaking, the way colour is specifically expressed in the petals of a rose is determined by various chromatic pathways, but only the surface of the petal is actually coloured, and this is made chiefly of sugar brought under the influence of enzymes which ferment the sugar until a compound, which will be the colour directed by the gene, is obtained. This is not done all in one step, but in a series of reactions, and in each case an enzyme is employed until the dye is mixed to its proper hue. A rose's prickles can be infrequent and small, or extremely nasty-looking and plentiful. They are shaped like needles, or are curved, hooked, or wing-shaped with dilated ends. Some are not so much prickles as bristles, while other species mix bristles and prickles, and yet others have prickles of different sizes on the same stem. A rose's leaves can be glossy, satiny, or matte, and of various sizes, textures, and shades of green, but the form of the leaves, or more precisely leaflets, is generally ovate or elliptical. The base is rounded, wedge form or heart-shaped, the apex tapering to a point, blunt or long-pointed, the edge margin simply or doubly serrated. A rose's hips vary in size and form from egg-shaped or spherical to elongated or bottle-like. The total structure and habit of plant growth also varies considerably. These days, plant structure is usually classified under seven headings: climber, rambler, bush, shrub, standard, ground cover, and miniature. Structure tends to be overlooked in accounts of the rose, as the main focus is, understandably, on the flowers. Furthermore, the preeminence of certain rose classes, especially the hybrid teas and floribundas, has led to an overall uniformity of plant structure, which has obscured the truly remarkable variety of possible rose growth habits. There is a huge difference between a climbing rose and a shrub rose, or between a dog rose and a typical modern garden rose. The importance of structure is also obscured by the role of pruning in relation to the newer roses, which is important to ensure tidy growth and maximum inflorescence, but robs them of any structural value during the winter season. The species roses are shrubs, climbers or ramblers, and have been around for a very long time, evolving 70 million years ago. It remains unclear just how many there are globally, and current estimates vary. One estimate puts it at around 160, 48 native to China, 42 in the rest of Asia, 32 in Europe, 6 in the Middle East, 7 in North Africa, and 26 in North America. Another suggests as many as 220 kinds of wild rose. These roses almost always have only 5 petals and are normally white or pink, sometimes with yellow stamens. But in referring to species or wild roses, we shouldn't make the mistake of assuming that this defines a group that is somehow pure and unchanging. More accurately, they are simply roses that evolved long ago through natural selection to their current state, which has endured for thousands of years. All plants possess the ability to randomly mutate to produce spores, which are mutations from the same parent plant, or to hybridize, which involves two different parent plants. A cultivar, meanwhile, is a non-wild reproduction, that is, a mutation planned by humans. In general, mutations tend to have a bad reputation, as the colloquial terms mutant, mongrel, and bastard demonstrate, but far from being nature's mistakes and a pollution of inherent purity, a chance mutation can be a vital aid to evolutionary success, because through the sharing of beneficial genes, an animal or a plant mutation contributes new adaptive strategies that increase the capacity to handle vastly different environmental conditions. That most mutations die out in the struggle for survival, and at various points in the distant past, species roses mutated more than 5 petals and may well have failed to pass on their genes had not some been taken in hand by humans because they took a fancy to and carefully cultivated them. In other words, the oldest domesticated garden roses were originally mutated species roses, and while many plant mutations have been selected by humans because of their usefulness, like rice and wheat, some, like the rose, have been selected largely thanks to our human predilection for beauty. But why do we find the rose in particular so beautiful? The botanist would point out that the rose seems exceedingly successful at capturing more than just the attention of pollinators, and that for both the bee and us, the rose's flower has basically the same function. It is a strong visual stimulus, a vegetal tool of attention capture. Through the logic of natural selection, flowers have adapted to invite and hold attention so as to profit from it. They use their shape, colour, and scent to communicate with other species and to attract insects and birds. The purpose of a flower is to send chemical signals, but it must also look and smell in distinctive ways so as to hold the attention of preferred pollinators. This means that all flowers are fundamentally oriented towards the satisfaction of the desires of other creatures, because success in garnering attention leads to an important payoff, more offspring for the plant. When wild roses in the hedgerows during the spring come into bloom, you have the impression that they have suddenly advanced into the world in order to grab the attention of their pollinators. But this standing out is also effected on an olfactory level through an alluring scent. Then, once the task is done, the blooms fade and fall, and the plant recedes again into the uniformity of its undifferentiated green background. What works for the honeybee also seems to work for us, and over time, some flowers, especially varieties of roses, absorbed into their survival protocols the benefits accrued through satisfying the desires of humans and, above all, the human desire for beauty. While a honeybee gets pollen in reward for its attention to a rose, we humans get beauty, And as Michael Pollan writes in The Botany of Desire, we, in turn, did our part, multiplying the flowers beyond reason, moving their seeds around the planet, writing books to spread their fame and ensure their happiness. For the flower, it was the same old story, another grand co-evolutionary bargain with a willing, slightly credulous animal. A good deal on the whole, though not nearly as good as the earlier bargain with the bees. But just what is beauty? The experience seems intimately linked to the conviction that despite plentiful evidence to the contrary, all is well with the world, which is why the French novelist Stendhal wrote, "Beauty is only a promise of happiness." From the point of view of a domesticated rose, what we call beauty is really nothing more nor less than the ground upon which its survival as a species is founded and furthered. Humans protect what they find beautiful, and so beauty is a passport to special benefits. When a five-petal species rose first mutated into a rose with bigger or more petals, like a gallica or a damask, this was not necessarily an advantage from the point of view of evolution, but with the intervention into the evolutionary process of the artificial selection planned by humans, such mutations were suddenly given a considerable advantage, and as a result, they prospered. For the rose, being judged beautiful is a survival strategy. 2. There are many kinds of roses. Living with the species and the sports. In Roman times, the British Isles, minus Ireland, were known as Albion, and Pliny the Elder thought this meant Island of White Roses, on account of the white roses growing there. Alba means white in Latin, and the white roses in question were probably Rosa pimpinellifolia. But nowadays it is believed that the pre-Celt reference to Albion may have derived from another prominently white feature of the island, one that is especially striking if invading from across the channel, the chalk cliffs of Dover. Rosa pimpinellifolia, a.k.a. the Scots rose, Burnet rose, or prickly rose, which, as the colloquial names suggest, is very bristly, is also very floriferous. One would probably also have been able to see in Albion, or Britannia, as the island was more officially known, members of the same rose family growing today up the wall of the cathedral in Hildesheim, the pink Rosa canina, the related species called the sweetbriar or eglantine, Rosa eglantaria, and the field rose, Rosa arvenis. Rosa canina is still a common sight today in southern England and Wales, and probably was in Roman Britain, while Rosa eglantaria especially grows on the chalkland of southern England, which in Roman times would still have been largely forested. Rosa eglantaria has flowers that are deeper pink than the dogs, and the unusual characteristic of possessing fragrant leaves, which smell rather like apples. A probably more recent import to Britannia is Rosa arvenis, from the Latin of cultivated fields, which suggests its favoured habitat. This is similar to the dog rose, but paler pink, almost white, and has a tendency not only to ramble into hedges and shrubs, but also to climb. Recent research suggests Rosa arvenis originates in the Middle East and is one of several species roses that migrated a considerable distance, perhaps with the Roman settlers. There would no doubt have been other roses which the Romans brought with them to the barbarous north. For example, one of the oldest...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.